Alcohol falls into the broad category of drugs, inebriants. Inebriants are substances that produce intoxication or inebriation. That means the person is let go of all his inhibitions and behaves in a stimulated or euphoric kind of way. The examples are alcohols, barbiturates, benzodiazepines, and chloralhydrate. Now, you can say that alcohol, how it can be inebriates, because after consumption of alcohol, the persons are euphoric, they're jumping about. So they should not be under with barbiturates and benzodiazepines and chloralhydrates, which are predominantly sedative hypnotic kind of drugs. So these are cerebral depressions. How can alcohol be a depression? But alcohol is a depression drug. In the initial phases, alcohol decreases the inhibitory functions of the higher centers. So our brain has an inhibitory control over our activities. It modulates how we should act, how we should talk. The time, place, and person orientation is an integral part of it. The way I talk with my colleagues, I cannot talk with that way with my students. And the way I talk with my parents is not the way I talk with my friends. So this kind of behavior modulation, depending on the company we are in or the situation we are in, is the result of these inhibitory functions of brain. Now, if you would have read the 5.1 story of by Chetan Bhagat, there the main protagonist Hari. Hari went to the exam done. So, and he tells things to the professor that normally he would never have dreamed of saying. And if you remember the film, Three Idiots, those guys, they were drunk and they go to the professor's house in the night. One of them tries to kiss his daughter. One of them urinates on his door. Normally, they wouldn't have dreamed of doing that. But they did that after being drunk, because alcohol depresses the inhibitory functions of the brain. So there's no inhibitory control on their actions, so they do whatever they want to. That's why alcohol is grouped under. Now, alcohols are usually compounds which have a hydroxyl group, OH. If there's only one hydroxyl group, they are monohydroxyl alcohols like ethanol, methanol, isopropanol, etc. Two hydroxyl groups are there in the ethylene glycol, polypropylene glycol, etc. And trihydroxyl alcohols is the glycerin. Now, the chapter proper, ethanol. They are produced synthetically from the ethylene. Commercially, to make into the beverage, they are produced by the fermentation of sugar, cellulose, or starch. Or also by the enzymatic hydrolysis of cellulose, ethanol can be produced. Okay. So, all the alcoholic beverages, they are produced by fermentation of the cellulose or a sugar or starch. Okay. So, we all know single malt, starch, or etc. So, the formation of malt is from a barley or any cereal, then from that malt, the scotch or whiskey is prepared. Beer is also prepared the same way, but the distillation is not done. So, all these alcoholic beverages, they contain alcohol, a certain percentage of the alcohol. This alcohol is present due to fermentation of the cellulose or starch. Now, as you can see, the lowest concentration of alcohol are there in the lagers. Lager is a type of beer. Lagers, they have 4 to 5% in general. ales for 4.5%. Then wines are the next category. They have 10 to 12% white wine. They have 10% red wine, 13% Chardonnay, 12.5%. Vodka, they have the highest quantity, 40% gin and rum, 42.5%. Rum is 45%. Tequila, 45%. Brandy, 42%. Whiskey, 50%. So these are the wine by volume percentage. Apart from the alcohol, so these are the only part. So we know that, so we have seen that the beverage, it contains 10%, 15%, 30%, 40% alcohol. So what about the rest? What is there in the beverage? The byproducts of the distillation and fermentation process, they are also present with that. And they are called congeners. They are like, as you have read in pharmacology, that for any commercial brand of medicine, apart from the active compound, there are some excipients. So in an alcoholic beverage also, apart from alcohol, there are some congeners. There are methanol. Methanol is one of the poisonous or more toxic byproducts. Methanol is metabolized into formaldehyde and formic acid. Formaldehyde is much more toxic to our body, and methanol, it produces the greatest amount of hangover, and it is mainly produced and it is found in the greatest quantities in the dark liquor. And methanol is responsible for all the deaths that happen due to poisonous liquor in the rural West Bengal and also in different other states like Bihar, UP, etc. Often there's a liquor tragedy. Consumed liquor, it turns poisonous and kills hundreds of people. And the main compound which is responsible is methanol. Furfuryl, tannins, oils, acetaldehyde, there are the other congeners. Now the amount of congener depends. It produces the hangover. So the hangover is the worst kind of feeling that you have after consumption of a certain amount of alcohol. Alcohol is a depression. So initially there will be euphoria due to depression of the inhibitory functions. But after that, the general brain function is inhibited. So the person feels sleepy. And after sleeping it off, in the next morning, there's this hangover. Hangover is a clouding of consciousness, persistent headache, sensitivity to light and sound. So this hangover, it is produced by these congeners. Pure alcohol does not produce hangover. So as you go from down to up, depending on the congener content, the hangover will be more. So in case of beer or vodka or gin, congener content is less, so hangover is less. But for rum, red wine or brandy, congener content is more, so hangover is likely to be more. Use as beverage, as solvent for aftershave, cologne, mouthwash, and in this COVID era, what we are using day to day life, maximum amount are the sanitizers. So the sanitizer, they contain alcohol. Perfumes, they contain alcohol. Content is different, 15 to 80%, but as we know, for surface sterilization, all the sanitizer, they contain 70% of ethanol or isopropyl alcohol depending on the brand. Now medicinal, several antihistaminic, decongestant and cough syrup, they contain varying percentage of alcohol. In fact, cough syrup are used for this purpose. Some cough syrups, like 4-H, they are banned because they are primarily consumed for their additive effect due to presence of the alcohol. Ethanol has been popular in the past as an antiseptic. Surgical spirit used even today is mostly ethanol with a small quantity of methanol. Spirit is used for disinfection in the surgery ward, on a regular basis. Surgery, gynae, for any kind of surgical ward, the disinfectant most commonly used is spirit. Even for a intravenous or intramuscular injection, put in an IV line, we always use spirit as a disinfectant. Antidote for methanol and ethylene glycol. How we'll discuss it in the later slides. Preservative, rectified spirit is used as a preservative for viscera. It contains 90 to 95% of ethanol. As we have discussed, for any kind of chemical analysis to detect poisons for the viscera, the ideal preservative is rectified spirit, and also it can be used as fuel. So these are the uses of alcohol. So these are the legal or legitimate uses. The difference between intoxication and toxicity. Intoxication is a transient condition of altered consciousness or behavior. That is, you consume a drug, due to effect of the drug for a certain period of time, you are free of your inhibitions and your right wrong considerations. So now your behavior is of a more carefree kind. You are euphoric and this is maladaptive kind of behavior. Maladaptive means your behavior does not conform with the norms of the society. That is called maladaptive behavior. A student urinating on the door of a teacher's house, that is a maladaptive kind of behavior, as was seen on the movie 3 Idiots. So that behavior of a student is that it does not conform with the norms of the society. Impairing, the person is unable to perform his normal functions, and it is reversible after some time. Usually no treatment is required. So that is intoxication. Toxicity is when your life is threatened, you have some signs and symptoms due to consumption of the drug over the safe limits. That is toxicity. This is the difference between toxicity and intoxication. Intoxication is not life-threatening, does not require any treatment. Toxicity is this life-threatening and treatment is required. Intoxication is due to consumption of an addictive drug in a sublethal quantity. Okay. So usual fatal dose. For alcohol, it's 6 grams of ethanol per kg body weight in case of an adult. And if you measure the blood alcohol concentration, above 500 milligram of alcohol per 100 ml of blood alcohol concentration of 500 is usually lethal. Okay. So now we'll discuss the toxicokinetics. Ethanol can be absorbed by all kinds of pathways. It is absorbable by oral, your ingestion, inhalation, injections, across skin, intraperitoneal, all kinds of routes. After oral ingestion, ethanol is rapidly absorbed from the mainly stomach 20% and mostly from the small intestine 80%. After that, so it is directly absorbed from stomach and small intestine into blood. So the peak alcohol concentration is reached from 30 to 90 minutes following the last drink. So it follows a curve. The more you drink, after 30 to 90 minutes of your last drink, your blood alcohol concentration will be at its zenith. Then it will be metabolized. This alcohol absorption from the stomach, it depends on these conditions. Food in the stomach, mainly oily food, fatty food, it delays the alcohol absorption. That's why alcohol is always consumed with some other food, which in common term is called chaat. So these fried food, pakoras, or whatever you ate, kebabs with alcohol, what they do, you with the food in the stomach, alcohol absorption is delayed. So it is gradually absorbed from the stomach and small intestine into blood, and blood alcohol concentration it increases on a slow manner. So you get drunk after a laundered period of time. So by that time you will reach your bed and you will fall asleep. But if you consume that, so for example, if you have enough food in you, then even after having 4 or 5 drinks, you may not be that drunk for an hour. But in empty stomach, if you had 8, 4 or 5 drinks of the same drink, you will be much more drunk or intoxicated within 30 minutes. That's the difference. Gender, as in the female, alcohol is mainly in the blood, and due to the differential fat deposition, the female, the blood alcohol concentration, it raises more rapidly. So females, they get drunk earlier or they get intoxicated earlier than male. Drug interaction with the other drugs like disulfiram. Disulfiram is used to combat alcohol addiction. How does it act? I will discuss in the next slide. Cigarette smoke. It potentiates alcohol absorption, mood and physical condition. Alcohol concentration is a factor. If you take a dilute drink, the alcohol absorption will be rapid. Carbonation, presence of carbonation with the aerated drink like soda or Coke, if you mix with the alcohol, this aeration, these gas bubbles, they increase the surface area. So alcohol absorption is facilitated. As more surface area is there, alcohol is available to be absorbed over a wider surface area. Diet soda, the same thing. Tolerance, for a habitual drinker, one who is drinking alcohol, he has developed, for a one who is drinking alcohol for 10 years or 15 years, he has developed enough tolerance. See, so he won't get intoxicated after 3 or 4 standard drinks. But for a novice, one who doesn't drink, if he suddenly drinks one day, so even after 2 standard drinks, he will be much more intoxicated because he doesn't have any tolerance. Now this is alcohol metabolism. There's 3 pathways. The major alcohol can be metabolized in the cytoplasm, inside the microsomes, or inside the peroxisomes in the liver. So mainly in the cytoplasm, this is the main pathway, alcohol or ethanol, it is acted upon by the enzyme alcohol dehydrogenase, ADH, to form acetaldehyde. This acetaldehyde enters mitochondria to be acted upon by mitochondrial alcohol dehydrogenase to convert into acetate. This acetate combines with the coenzyme A to form acetyl-CoA and enters into the other pathways. So this is the major pathway. So during oxidation from ethanol to acetaldehyde, NAD plus, it is reduced into NADH plus H plus. Okay, so NADH by NAD plus ratio increases. This is one of the major pathway. The 2 other minor pathways in the microsome, they are cytochrome enzymes UIP2E1. Here the other thing happens, it also here NADPH plus H plus, it is oxidized into NADP plus and ethanol is converted to acetaldehyde. And in peroxisomes, catalase enzyme, what it does, it breaks down into H2O2, hydrogen peroxide, into water, and this oxygen is used in oxidation of ethanol into acetaldehyde. Okay. So this is what happens in peroxisomes. So all pathways, as the proverb goes, all roads lead to Rome. All metabolic pathways of ethanol ends up into generation of acetaldehyde. That acetaldehyde again is oxidized into acetate. So, and in this mitochondria, during this phase, due this acetaldehyde to acetate, reactive oxygen species are formed. So that's a byproduct of alcohol metabolism. That's how alcohol is metabolized. Now, what happens? This, as I said, not only ethanol, the methyl alcohol or methanol is also follows the same pathway. But the affinity of this enzyme alcohol dehydrogenase, it is much more for the ethyl alcohol than methyl alcohol or methanol. So in methanol toxicity or nutrient, when methanol is acted upon by the enzyme alcohol dehydrogenase to form formaldehyde, then formic acid. Formaldehyde is a toxin metabolite. It produces a certain sign and symptoms that we'll discuss in the next class. So ethyl alcohol is the antidote. It will compete with the methyl alcohol for the alcohol dehydrogenase. The enzyme prefers ethyl alcohol. So ethyl alcohol will be oxidized into acetaldehyde and so on and so forth, and methyl alcohol will be there unchanged. Formaldehyde will not be produced, so there will be no toxicity. That is the mechanism why ethyl alcohol is the antidote. It is used in methyl alcohol poisoning. Now elimination. After metabolism, there's elimination. Now more than 90% of ethanol ingested is metabolized in the body. 5 to 10% is excreted unchanged by kidney, lungs, and sweat. The excretion of the ethanol, it is guided by Henry's law. Henry's law says C is equal to Kp. C is the concentration of a dissolved gas. P is the partial pressure of the gaseous solute, and K is the Henry's law of proportionality constant. So it says that when the pressure is 1 bar, gas will be dissolved in the liquid into by this 3%. Okay. So when a certain amount, but if the pressure is doubled, the partial pressure gets doubled, concentration of the dissolved gas in the solution will also get doubled. So here the 3 parts of the gas is dissolved, here 6 parts of the gas is dissolved because pressure is doubled. That means ratio of the pressure is constant with the ratio of the concentration. So imagine this is the alveoli. This blue water is actually the blood inside the alveolar capillaries in the wall, in the alveolar wall. And this is the alveolar air. Now this certain amount of alcohol is a volatile liquid. So certain amount of this alcohol crosses across the semi-permeable membrane, that is the capillary wall, into the alveolar air. So as you continue drinking, your blood alcohol concentration gets doubled. So alcohol partial pressure of the alcohol in the alveolar air, that will also get doubled. As the solubility increases, partial. Now the mode of action. Earlier it was thought that alcohol depresses the CNS by dissolving the lipid cell membrane of the nerves, neurons. But then it was shown by some experimental studies that to achieve that kind of membrane fluidization, the concentration of alcohol needs to be much more higher. So the present theories are: alcohol enhances the function of the GABA-A receptor mediated chloride channels. These are inhibitory neurotransmitters. Inhibitory neurochannels is the... So, they say, so the brain function is depressed. Another one is there's another glutamate receptor. Here the neurotransmitter is glutamate, and the ligand data channel is the NMDA. NMDA is the ligand. Alcohol, what it does, it inhibits function of this channel. Glutamate is an excitatory neurotransmitter. If that is inhibited, so brain function will be depressed. Clinical features. Alcohol, the phase is divided into three phases: phase of excitement, phase of incoordination, phase of narcosis. Now, initially, up to blood alcohol concentration 0 to 50 is the stage of sobriety. Normal. Blood alcohol concentration 50 to 100 milligram per 100 ml is a stage of euphoria. The person is happy, talkative. He laughs loudly, talks too much, increased self-confidence. Ma'am, I can do anything. That's the kind of feeling that have. Fine movements are affected. Fine movements mean there will be fine tremor in the hand, handwriting will be changed, etc. Next is 100 to 150, the stage of excitement. Here the person is much more excited. The reaction time increases. Reaction time increases, so that will hamper the driving. For driving, you have to have excellent hand-eye coordination and a very small reaction time. And mild ataxia is also common. Now, then comes the stage of incoordination, 150 to 200. Then there's confusion, disorientation, vertigo, diplopia, slurred speech, stuttered in gait, etc. So this is called stage of incoordination. And in India, the permissible limit of blood alcohol concentration for driving is 15%. That is up to this. Okay. When you are in this stage, you are no longer fit for driving. 200 to 300 stupor or general inertia, diminished response to stimuli. So now the stage of narcosis starts. The person is drowsy, sleepy, he can't walk, just increased nausea. 300 to 500 is stage of coma. The person goes into unconsciousness, abolish reflexes, there's hypothermia, urinary or fetal incontinence, respiratory compromise. So now, as I said, above 500, it's fatal. So that can be death due to respiratory failure. So the seven stages in relation to the blood alcohol concentration. You need to remember this. What are the other features? Cardiac arrhythmias are common, mainly the tachyarrhythmias, usually the atrial fibrillation after a binge drinking. Through the all seven stages of alcohol intoxication or ethanol intoxication, a distinct odor is perceptible in the breath. This odor is partly due to alcohol and partly due to some volatile hydrocarbons present as congeners. Ethanol is midriatic. It dilates the pupil, but towards the terminal stages, it can constrict the pupil for a short period of time. McEwan's sign is an unreliable sign, but it's usually in the older books of forensic medicine, it was a celebrated sign as a confirmatory sign. But now the present view is it is uncommon and unreliable. So here the pupils are contracted in the stages of stupor, but on an external painful stimulation by pinching of the cheek or by light slapping, pupil dilate, but then it again contracts. So that is called McEwan sign. It is seen in alcoholic coma, but again I want to reiterate that it's not a reliable sign. Hypothermia is common. The body temperature goes down. Hypotension and tachycardia may be present. As I said, again, atrial fibrillation and also atrioventricular block have been reported in acute overdose. After consuming recreational amounts of alcohol, that is, you drink in the parties, three pages, four pages, some form of variant angina may be there. So it is a common occurrence that after a party, when the person has consumed some amount of alcohol and food, then he has an anginal pain. But then cardiac failure, arrhythmias, or subclinical labial dysfunction, other abnormalities of the heart are seen. Alcoholic cardiomyopathy is a recognized entity. It has insidious onset and it goes clinically apparent, and then it suddenly manifests as a cardiac failure. Now, the eye features. The alcohol causes a host of changes in the eye. There are poor control of eye movements, diplopia, that is the double vision, and nystagmus. Nystagmus is a jerky movement of the eyeball. Here, as the person is seen straight, you will see that the pupil is jerking left to right, or up and down. So this nystagmus can be horizontal, vertical, and it can be spontaneous or gaze evoked. Spontaneous nystagmus means the eyeball is jerking laterally always, and gaze evoked means when the person moves the eye to gaze at a particular point, nystagmus starts. In case of an acute overdose of ethanol, spontaneous horizontal nystagmus is seen. But all other nystagmuses are possible in alcohol. Amblyopia. Amblyopia is a dimness of vision without any apparent cause. But it is more commonly due to defective development of the neural pathways. And here, amblyopia is seen in alcohol due to optic neuritis in chronic alcoholics. Okay. So, lactate or T2 acidosis may occur. Alcoholic acidosis is a known entity due to NADH overproduction. Alcohol is oxidized into acid, so that goes without saying that there will be a metabolic acidosis. Decreased lactate utilization, as there is more and more acetyl-CoA, lactic acid is not utilized, and inhibition of hepatic gluconeogenesis. Hypoglycemia, which can result in seizure and coma, is a serious complication of acute alcoholic intoxication, especially in children. Why does hypoglycemia? Due to inhibition of the hepatic gluconeogenesis. Why does inhibition of hepatic gluconeogenesis? Due to more lactic acid, more acetyl-CoA acidosis. Okay, so these are all related. How to diagnose alcoholism? Bedside test is you take the sample, unknown sample, maybe the vomitus. The person has vomited, so you take the vomitus, stain it, and take the liquid part. Put 1 ml of acetic acid and 1 drop of H2SO4, and heat gently for 1 minute. There will be ethyl acetate formed, which gives a strong fruity odor. Then you can go for testing the blood alcohol concentration by the immunoassay or gas chromatography. BCMS is the most commonly used method in India. You have to monitor the ABG or the arterial blood gases due to development of metabolic acidosis. Electrolytes, glucose, hypoglycemia, hypokalemia, metabolic acidosis as may occur. So you have to monitor ABG, electrolytes, and glucose. The urea, creatinine, liver transaminase, and CPT may be useful in identifying the hepatotoxicity or rhabdomyolysis. Chronic poisoning is, alcoholism is a condition that, as it goes with all other drugs of abuse, a person, he consumes regularly over a certain amount of alcohol for a long period of time. Then he develops the condition of alcoholism, and it is characterized by 3 features. Number 1, pathological desire for alcohol intake. He cannot go by a single day without drinking alcohol. And if he doesn't date it, there will be withdrawal symptoms on seizing the alcohol intake. And during intoxication, there will be blackouts. So these are the chronic alcoholics. Blackout means he will drink alcohol, then he will get unconscious, and then he will regain consciousness in the next morning. And he doesn't remember how he lost consciousness or that he had even drunk a drop of alcohol. He would deny it. So that's the feature of chronic alcoholism. And not only that, these two features, pathological desire, withdrawal dependence, and withdrawal symptoms, these are the three cardinal points of drug addiction. In the chapter of drug abuse, we will discuss about drug addiction, habituation, etc. terms. You will see that there, this pathological desire for intake, a dependence on the drug, and withdrawal symptoms. These are the three cardinal points of a drug addiction. Now, this alcohol addiction or chronic alcoholism, it is often not diagnosed by doctors because the patient, they do not report it. And they often report it with some certain weight symptoms like constipation, acidity, etc. But they do not confess that they are alcoholics. So on the part of a doctor, you have to be there, have to be a persistent and high index of suspicion. Now, how do you measure the drinking of alcohol? Whether he drinks more or less. So this is the limit. This is one unit. Half a pint of ordinary beer contains one unit. So one pint is 2 units. One small glass of wine is one unit. One single measure of any spirit, scotch or whiskey, single measure, or a small glass of sherry, or a single measure of any wine. So these are the standard unit, one unit. So current opinion is 21 units more than a week for men is a problem. So if a person says that I drink 3 times a week, two pints of beer. So 3 into 2, 6 units, 6 pints. 6 pints is 12 units. So that's well within limit. Okay. I take spirit. Small measure, but size 4 such or 6 such. This is 30 ml. Yes, in 60 ml. So 6 or 8 such on 3 times a week. So then it becomes what? 12 into 3, 36 units. So that then it's a problem. So the limit is 21 units per week for men, 14 units per week for women. Complications of chronic alcoholism. In GIT, the problems are gastritis, periodic diarrhea, increased incidence of oropharyngeal or esophageal cancer. As we know, alcohol is a known carcinogen. In liver, it is the strong hepatotoxic drug. It will cause fatty liver with the portal hypertension, hepatitis, cirrhosis, increased incidence of hepatic carcinoma. In all chronic alcoholism, a fatty liver or a pre-cirrhotic condition is quite common. Pancreas, there can be acute or chronic pancreatitis or development of pancreatic cancer. CVS, it causes cardiomyopathy, as I said, alcoholic cardiomyopathy, dysarrhythmias or hypertension. In CNS, it causes a polyneuropathy or cerebral degeneration. And then there's a rare syndrome, it's called Martiofava-Bidnami disease. There are 2 Italian doctors, one is Dr. Martiofava and Dr. Bidnami. They identified this syndrome. This, over a certain period of time, then hundreds of literature cases were reported where chronic alcoholics were reported to the hospital by seizure or sudden death. And on autopsy, it was seen that corpus callosum shows necrosis and hemorrhage. And on a live subject, the MRI of the brain shows demyelination in the areas of corpus callosum. That is Martyrfaba Vietnami disease. Amblyopia, stroke, etc. seen. In respiratory system, there will be aspiration pneumonia or alcohol-induced asthma. So these are the all the medical complications of alcoholism, and the list is endless. There are hundreds of more, and there are hundreds of other complications of alcoholism. Right, endocrine, hypogonadism, feminization in males, amenorrhea, menorrhagia, and infertility in females, Sjögren-Pochin syndrome. Blood, in blood it can cause anemia or thrombocytopenia. In skeletal muscle system, it can cause myopathy. Neuropsychiatric syndromes are quite common. It causes amnesia, blackout, delusions, and delirium tremens, or it is encephalopathy, or sort of psychosis. These three are part of the delirium tremens is part of the withdrawal spectrum, and we will discuss in the next slides. And there's teratogenicity. Alcohol has teratogenic potential. Alcoholic mothers are known to give birth to fetus with deformities, like fetal alcohol syndrome, and carcinogenicity, as I said earlier. So the sudden cessation of alcohol intake in a chronic alcoholic person will invoke a withdrawal reaction. Withdrawal reaction can manifest in many forms. So first, the common abstinence syndrome. It is the commonest one, as the name suggests. Any person who is chronic alcoholic has not drunk alcohol for 6 to 8 hours. There can be fine tremors of the hands, leg, and trunk. They are called shakes, alcoholic shakes. The person will be agitated. He can turn violent. There will be a headache. He will be difficulty in sleeping, nausea, etc. So this is the common abstinence syndrome. After 24 to 36 hours, there will be hallucinations. Hallucinations are objects will appear distorted in shape. There will be shadows moving, shouting, or snatches of the music will be heard. So these are the auditory hallucinations. So these are the alcoholic hallucination. Then after 40 hours, there will be ram fits or seizures. There are tonic-clonic movements without loss of consciousness. Then comes the most life-threatening one, alcoholic ketoacidosis. After 40 to 72 hours, this is a part of the withdrawal spectrum. With heavy drinking, after episodes of heavy drinking, it can occur, or as well as what happens that the person goes on a binge drinking trip to celebrate a certain occasion. This alcohol is accompanied with intake of proteins like meat or kebabs, but no carbohydrate. So to compensate for the loss of the carbohydrate and the depleted glycogen stores, body will metabolize fat from the adipose tissue. And in that metabolism, ketone body will be produced. So there will be ketoacidosis. Treatment, you give fluid, ampelle of fluid. After giving ampelle of fluid, you have to do a potassium supplementation and vitamin B1, thiamine. This is mandatory to prevent the development of Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome. Then comes one celebrated feature, delirium tremens. Delirium tremens occurs after 3 to 5 days of a period of binge drinking. So after a period of binge drinking, the person suddenly stops drinking alcohol. So after 3 to 5 days, there are dramatic onset of a disordered mental activity. The consciousness is clouded. There's no time-space orientation. There's certain degree of loss of recent memory. There's dehydration, electrolyte disturbances, blood will show leukocytosis and impaired liver function. Now, in the DSM-5 diagnostic manual, in the DSM-5, the withdrawal delirium, there is a diagnostic criteria. There are two parts. One is a criteria for alcohol withdrawal, and then a criteria for delirium. So, what are the criteria for alcohol withdrawal? Cessation of or reduction in heavy or prolonged use of alcohol, followed by two of the eight possible symptoms. What are the eight? Number one, autonomic hyperactivity, like there will be high rate of pulse, tachycardia, tachypnea, etc. And tremor of the hands, insomnia, nausea, vomiting, transient hallucinations or illusions, psychomotor agitation, anxiety, or generalized tonic-clonic seizures. So here's alcoholic hallucination, alcoholic seizure or RAM fits, anxiety, nausea. These are the part of the chronic abstinence, the common abstinence syndrome. So whatever I've told about till now about alcohol withdrawal, they are all part of this eight symptoms. Of these eight, two must be present. And for the delirium, there is a decreased attention and awareness. There's a time place coordination. He doesn't know where he is, how he has come here. Disturbance in the attention or awareness, memory, orientation, language. The person can use foul language or slangs. Visuospatial ability, perception, the perception is dim, and all of these abilities that changes from normal, and no evidence of coma or other evolving neurocognitive disorder. That's a must. There must not be any other cognitive disorder. So if there's cessation of alcohol with two of the eight symptoms, so there's alcohol withdrawal, and there's this spectrum of delirium. So withdrawal plus delirium is equal to delirium tremens. Treatment: in a reassuring environment, you give diazepam 10 mg IV to calm the patient. And once he is calm, continue that by oral or IV. Then you have to give IV thiamine 100 mg to stop development of Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome. And you have to correct the fluid and electrolyte imbalance. That's how you treat delirium tremens. Now, what is Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome? It is a clubbing of two distinct entities. One is Wernicke's encephalopathy. It was named after the Dr. Carl Wernicke. It is an acute reversible stage produced in alcoholics due to vitamin B1 deficiency. And if this acute reversible stage converts into a chronic irreversible stage, it is named Korsakoff syndrome after the name of Dr. Sergei Korsakoff. What is Wernicke's encephalopathy? It is characterized by a triad of confusion, ophthalmoplegia, and ataxia. So it is a triad of confusion, ophthalmoplegia, ataxia produced due to thiamine deficiency. So the mnemonic is COAT, COAT. And for the Korsakoff psychosis, there's retrograde amnesia or anterograde amnesia. So there will be amnesia and confabulation. Korsakoff psychosis have two parts. One is amnesia, can be anterograde or retrograde. And next one is confabulation. What is confabulation? Confabulation is the person manufactures stories. He can manufacture events that never has happened. So he will say that in the year of 1980, I went to Mumbai, I did that, I met Amitabh Bachchan, I dined with Rekha, etc., etc. But, and he believes those. he believes to the in the core of his heart that he has really went to Mumbai and met Amitabh Bachchan and dined with Rekha, but that never happened. So this is called confabulation. It is in Korsakoff psychosis. So for the Korsakoff psychosis, the mnemonic is rat. So you can remember Wernicke Korsakoff psychosis by the mnemonic coat rat. Okay. So with that, alcohol withdrawal is finished. So now we have seen alcohol metabolism, elimination, then the alcohol acute intoxication, then acute toxicity, chronic toxicity, their medical complications, and alcohol withdrawal. Now, how you will treat an acute alcohol intoxication? A drunk person, an intoxicated person has brought to you in the emergency. The person is comatose, there is tachycardia, tachypnea, and breath of alcohol is evident from the smell of alcohol is there. How you will treat it? First, you protect the airway, regularize breathing by the ventilatory support, and for the circulation, you put an IV line and you start IV fluids. Activated charcoal is not useful. Stomach wash can be given. Thiamine 100 mg IV must be given to prevent development of Wernicke's Korsakoff psychosis. Dextrose to combat the hypoglycemia, and also these dextrose will help prevent the development of T2 acidosis, which is produced due to hypoglycemia. So the IV fluid that are given, they are given usually DNS or D5. Intravenous fluid, as I said. Then a variety of drugs have been tried to hasten the elimination of alcohol. None effect. However, recently it is seen that flumazenil, which is the antidote for benzodiazepines, it is shown to be effective in the experimental studies to reverse the respiratory depression associated with ethanol injection. And in severe cases, you can try hemodialysis. So that's all for the acute alcohol intoxication. Alcohol will be continued in the next class when I will talk about the medico-legal aspects of alcohol intoxication, how it is associated with crime, drunken driving, breath analysis, and methyl alcohol poisoning and ethylene glycol poisoning. So thank you very much for your time and patience. Please go through the chapter, and if you have any doubt, feel free to reach to me. Thank you very much.